This is what we call paradigm, a frame of reference, which you can use irrespective of any discipline or any branch of knowledge. You just remove that and you have to put your own. For example, for a medical man, either here in India or past, present or future, reality is for him is the health is the reality. Arogya, health. So for him, he must realize what is he is going to do for the patient. So disease, disorder, signs, symptoms, all that language is the same. But the reality is this, that healthy man, what is healthy man? He has to realize, first define what is reality. So young man, health will depend on his perspective looking at the whole world. Just as Ayurveda says, the term Ayurveda means science of life. Ayuh means life. And Ayurveda, Veda means knowledge, total knowledge, Ayurveda. But Ayuh means life, but that word itself means continuity of life. Right from birth to death, he just born and died. There is no continuity. So what we call today sustainable performance, continued performance. So Ayuh means that which always keeps on continuing. Up to what level? He died, again took birth, again took birth, again took birth. So I died, my son is there, my son will die, his son will there. So that continuity. So Ayuh means any life which contains life and maintains continuity. Akita Brahma Dehe, from insect to the Lord Brahma. If you don't believe Brahma, it's okay, doesn't matter. But it means whosoever is the highest realized, highest man is called that. So right from microbes, insects, vegetables, animals, birds, human beings and perfected beings like Christ, or if we believe in Mahmud or Ram or Krishna or Nanishwadis. So it is a continuity and continuum. And therefore, this you have to have first define what is reality for you and then try to realize it. First make it self-experience, and after experience, then only you can express it. So experience is subjective, express is objective, and unless you express, you cannot manifest. So manifestation itself means that which is subjective, that which is abstract, you make it concrete and you make it manifested. So this is the process, and so this is common for all discipline. So once you have to decide health, then health of what? Health, H capital means all living beings, from microbe to human beings or gods or goddesses. And if it is small, then it is a part of it. Then it will be individual also, or it will be localized also, or it will be national, international, anything. So there will be a hierarchy or levels. So first we have to define that, and that reality, unless you realize it, you cannot have manifestation, or you cannot have application of it. So in a way, this is applied science. And now you will say, what is the difference between Ganita and Sutra and all those things? So we have said that Ganita Jnana, and we have said Sutra Jnana, and we have said there Vyavahara Jnana, and we have said Prayoga Jnana. Can you give some example? I can just give a small example from different contexts, but you can apply it. For example, when somebody sees there was a rainfall, soil was good and there was rain, and then next day the farmer went and put seeds into that. And after that, 1 week, after 1 week he went and he found that there is a growth of crop. So he found that within 8 days, the crop was about, say, 1 foot high, 1 foot. So he expressed, oh, it's good. So after rain season, I find that it's grown up. It has become a small shrub. But small shrub is a common expression. It is of a common man. It is not a scientific expression. It is not of the researcher experiment. He must speak very precisely. Then he will say, who is a, that farmer's son was studying in college. So then he said, father, this is not correct. It has in 1 week that seed has blossomed and has taken shape, and it is 1 feet. Within one week, that tree, that small shrub has become 1 feet high. So this is a scientific statement. His father was giving ordinary statement. So in a way, some kind of quantity, some kind of defined or definition. But he was not a student of mathematics. A student of mathematics will say, if it has grown up in 1 week, 1 feet, 1 foot, then how much the rate, growth of rate in 1 minute, in 2 minutes or 1 hour? So that again, deeper and deeper analysis will become Ganita Pratyaksha. It is Ganita Pratyaksha. His father was talking about Vyavahara Pratyaksha because he is related and it's for him it is okay. But his student was Shastra Pratyaksha because he is talking science. And Tattvajnan will say something else. It is ever growing. It will again grow tomorrow. And it was also in the past. It was also in Europe, also in America. So that abstract philosophical is Tattva Pratyaksha. It was a Tattva Pratyaksha. So this is what we call subjective and objective. Now understand three words more. So as I said, you can use this format for any discipline, whether it is yoga or Ayurveda or allopathy or homeopathy or physics, chemistry, mathematics, management, law, anywhere, because these steps are common. So these are about 10 or 11 steps. Now we said that this is knowledge is, as I said, requires first direct knowledge, which is based on sense perceptions, sense objects outside, and processing of the sense faculties, and observer, like a scientific experiment. He is a scientist, is an observer, he is doing some experiment, he is observing something, and then concluding and giving write up definition, descriptions and all those things. This is called direct perception. But as we have seen last time, direct perception is the most important source of getting knowledge. Nothing is like that. But it comes to, when you look it from a global point of view, you find that knowledge which you get directly compared to the knowledge available in the whole world, it is as small seed in the whole ocean. Direct knowledge is most important. Magnitude or area or volume compared to that which is not direct is mind-bogglingly bigger. You understand? Very small. Our direct knowledge, whatever we see, for us it is very big. But compared to the totality of knowledge, the knowledge gained by direct perception is as bigger as particle in the whole ocean or a small drop in the whole ocean. It means that there are limitations of direct perception. Therefore, we have to find out some way to acknowledge or to find out way how to get that which is not directly perceived. So it is called apratyaksha jnana, indirect perception. Indirect perception. In other words, indirect perception is far, far infinite compared to direct perception. It is infinitesimal while it is infinite. Just that point and infinity, and instant and eternity. Instant and infinity is a term for space, time. Point and infinity is the term for space or geometry. So this is the way. And another thing is, which our ancient India has given a most vital point underlining, is that everyone believes in direct perception, no doubt about that. As I say, it is very small. What is required for direct perception? That there is knowledge, knower, precept knowledge, and what is to be known, these three. It means that it must have some kind of object before you, and some kind of observer, and the connection between the observer and the object is called processing. So three things are required: knower, knowledge, and object of knowledge. Singer, process of singing, and what he wants to sing. So this trinity is common everywhere. So this is three. But he says that we define direct perception in relation to these three. That itself is not really giving you a real direct perception, as our ancient people say. In other words, though we definitely believe that concrete knowledge is important than the abstract knowledge, abstract has no sense. But he says that this is a very superficial discrimination, very superficial observation, very superficial understanding. It is not contemplative or concentrated or meditative thought. It is very common thought. Why? He says that how do you get this knowledge? By what? So you require some kind of observer, that is human being. Observer. And observer, human being, even the observer himself is not seen. And through which does he observe? Either through eyes, either through ear, through nose, through mouth, tasting, or through touching. So these we call four faculties: vision, audition, tactation, all this. So only when these organs go out and catch that object, you don't get knowledge. We can see eyes, we can see ear, we can see nose, we can see tongue. But the faculty which govern this or which prompt these organs, where are they? So those faculties through which you get the direct knowledge themselves are abstract, not seen. Do you accept this? Eyes are seeing, ears are hearing, tongue is tasting. But these are the organs. Who controls these organs? That abstract faculties we call sense faculties. We in Sanskrit we call jnanendriyas. Well, these were karmendriyas. So so-called concrete knowledge is itself is abstract, because the sense faculties through which sense organs work, they themselves are abstract. They themselves are not seen, unseen. Therefore, the whole knowledge is nothing but abstract and unseen. Is it clear? And again, not only that, he says, what you call direct perception itself changes from person to person. Even if you are yourself, that also you will change from today or tomorrow or after tomorrow. And what he says, again, look into this phenomenon properly, then you will realize that this direct perception itself is not exactly direct perception. The knowledge which you get is really speaking not yet directly proved, because though it fulfills that seen sense, no, one who is seer, one who is seeing, one who is the process of seeing, and what he sees, certain things which are missing again. What are those? He says that if you are too close to the object, you do not get the knowledge of the object properly. Ati samipad, if it is too close, then you are not able to get proper knowledge. Though three things are given, three require three things: knowledge of observer, what is to be observed, and what is the observation process. All these three are there. But if it is not properly distanced, if there is no proper distance, if it is too close, then also you do not get proper knowledge of that what you want to get. Or if you are too far, then also you do not get knowledge. So ati durat, if it is too far, I know that there is something, but it is too far that my friend has put it there, but I am not able to see because it is too long distance. So too long a distance also do not give you proper direct perception. Too small a distance also will not give you proper perception. If I look at this TV picture, if I go to the near there, and not, I am not able to see that properly. So just exact distance also is required between that person and the knowledge. Is it clear? So distance is important. Too long and too short also doesn't help. And also certain other things. Suppose now I have here white cloth and suddenly I put another white drop of paint on the white cloth. Then also I am not able to distinguish that white drop put on the white cloth of white color. So because this small loses its individuality, and in other words, it gets defeated. So we cannot distinguish between that. So our knowledge again, though things are what all those three criteria are there, even then you cannot get off that spot properly. It is called samanabhibhavat, being defeated by the bigger one, so that you are not able to see that. Not only that, I know that there is something on your backside, photo, but from front side I am not able to see that. So it is also there, but because there is some obstruction, there is some interference, there is something which prevents me to get that knowledge. So if there is something which obstructs the knowledge, interference, as we say in science experiments, double slit, single slit, mono slit experiments, that interference, interferometer, doesn't allow you to have proper knowledge. So this also, so these are already four or five. Everything is there. But if your mind is not stable, if it is not set up, if your mind is upset, then also you do not get that knowledge. Manasa anavasthanat. So because your mind is also not tuned, so though everything is there, you do not get direct perception. So because of this, he says, whatever you call direct perception needs to be supported by other lower means of knowledge, what is called epistemology. So inference. So if you are here, it means that you had father. You say your father is no more, but you had father, because without father you cannot get. So this is indirect perception because of this causality, relationship, cause and effect relationship. Here then we get knowledge, but indirectly. From known, you go to unknown. From concrete, you go to abstract. So this way, this is called secondary type of knowledge. But you have to prove your direct perception to other means. And sometimes, this is called indirect knowledge, indirect proof. It is called not major, but minor proof. But it is also important. So this was indicated knowledge, and then inference, because of this you are inferring, if 2 plus 2 is 4, then 4 plus 4 would be 8, this inference.